So welcome, everyone. It is fantastic to be with all of you for the first virtual event of 2021, and to be with three remarkable members of the Bowdoin community, Jeff Canada, George Khaldun, and Stanley Druckenmiller. Those of you that have done these before, the format will largely follow the other events, which is that I'll do a short introduction. I'll offer up the first few questions to get things warmed up, but the bulk of the hour will be taken up with the questions that you all have for our three Bowdoin polar bears. You can use the Q&A function in Zoom, which by now I am sure you are intimately familiar with, and I'll curate those and throw questions at each of the three guys. And try to mix them up so we get different subjects and different points of view and so forth into the mix here. None of the three members of the Bowdoin community who are with us today need an introduction, and it would take a long time to do it in an adequate manner for each of them, but I'll offer a brief one in any event. Geoff Canada, born and raised in the South Bronx by a single mother, moved to Long Island to live with his grandparents during high school. And it was from there that he came to Bowdoin College, graduated in 74, honorary degree in 07. Jeff went on to get a master's in education from Harvard. He founded and was the CEO of the Harlem Children's Zone in 1990, retiring from that position, but not from active involvement with the zone in 2014. Jeff is one of the most consequential figures in American education today and has advised all manner of leaders and educators in the work that we all do to improve the American educational system, including at Bowdoin. George Khaldun, born and raised in New York City, to which he also came to Bowdoin, graduated in 1973. George was a co-founder with Jeff of the Harlem Children's Zone and acted as the chief administrative officer and chief operating officer for all the years that Jeff was there. They were really side by side in doing this work together. Today, George is a speaker and consultant on issues of leadership and has spoken at organizations as varied as the United Nations, the Department of State, and the Aspen Institute on those issues. And Stanley Druckenmiller, born in Pittsburgh, raised in Pittsburgh and in New Jersey, I think, as well, and in Virginia, Stan, if I have that right. Bowdoin class of 1975, honorary degree in 2007. Stan is, as I'm sure you all know, a legendary investor, one of the most successful investors in the world. He is also, along with his wife Fiona, one of the most generous, sophisticated, philanthropists in the country. There are a number of organizations that have benefited enormously from Stan's both generosity but guidance as well. Bowdoin is one of them in a profound way. New York University, Memorial Sloan Kettering Hospital, to name two others, and of course the Harlem Children's Zone. He's been a major financial benefactor and chair of the board for many, many years and was an advisor and worked with Jeff and with George in the work that they did there. So, gentlemen, welcome back to Bowdoin. I'm sorry we're not in the in Pickard Theater on the stage, but it's great to be with you and great to be with so many folks from the Bowdoin community that are here today. And I want to encourage our audience to lob questions in. We've got a few that have come in already, but put them into the Q&A function. We do have closed captioning also. For those who require it or would find it helpful in viewing the session. I want to start actually with Bowdoin, and all of you have talked to me both in the context of the session today, but over many years about your the profound impact that Bowdoin College had on you personally and the involvement that Bowdoin has had over the years in larger ways and smaller ways in the founding and in the growth of the Harlem Children's Zone. And so I'd like to talk first just from and hear from each of you about what Bowdoin meant to you personally. We'll just go around, start with Jeff and then George and Stan.
Thank you, Clayton, and happy to almost be back on the campus and excited about being with the students and faculty and people I love who are on the screen. You know, there would not have been a Harlem Children's Zone. My life trajectory would not have taken the course that it did had it not been for Bowdoin. You know, people say things like that, but for me, coming from the South Bronx, a community that was literally falling down around me in the late 60s, early 70s, I had this thirst for solutions, and I didn't have a clue of how I was going to figure out how I was going to save these children and families growing up in the conditions that I grew up in. And I got to Bowdoin. The reason that it was so profound was I met folks like George, who's on the screen. These were the smartest, most articulate African-Americans I had ever met. I'd never met anyone like these folks who were on the campus. I remember thinking, how can I get to be like them? You know, I kind of watched my evolution at Bowdoin from being a C student as a freshman to a B student as a sophomore, and later as an A student as I got sort of grounded in the academics here. And I've used that experience throughout my entire career. So literally, as far as I'm concerned, Bowdoin put me on a trajectory to start the Harlem Children's Home.
Thank you, Jeff. George?
Well, I came to Bowdoin in 1968. It was right after the riots and racial conflict, which was happening primarily in inner cities. And when the people I came to Bowdoin with, we were all mostly people who were coming from the inner cities, and we had revolution on our mind. And when I came to Bowdoin, many of us had read Mein Kampf, many of us had read Mao Zedong, most of us were socialists or communists or Muslims. So we were active people, we were involved with the struggle. So we came to Bowdoin, or many of us came to Bowdoin to try to find out and get information how we can develop our intellectual ability and our capabilities so that we can take these skills and go back to our communities to make change. And I learned so much being here because Bowdoin helped me in terms of developing my intellectual powers in terms of focus. And it gave me the strength and insight in terms of, and the skills that allowed me to go back and do something about the horrible conditions that Black people were living in the inner cities. And when I got here in my senior year, sophomore year, I met Ken Chenault, who was one of my suite mates at Bowdoin, and another guy named Germa Purcell. He was from Eritrea. And when we graduated, Germa went back to Eritrea and became a general in the army because they were fighting for freedom. And Ken Chenault went on to Harvard, and you know his history. So I went back, came back to the community and lived in Bermuda for a while. And then a number of years later, I ran into Geoffrey Canada. And he reminded me about what we said we were going to do when we got back to our communities. We were going to build and change the conditions of our people in Harlem and the Harlems around the country. So Bowdoin gave me an opportunity to meet brilliant young men like Jeff and others, and gave me the skills that I harnessed in order to help me to become a better administrator and a better communicator for our people.
Thank you, George. Stan?
Well, I came to Bowdoin a little different path. I came from a middle-class community, all white, rich from Virginia. And I'll never forget what a culture shock I had the first week. I go into this class by Professor John Rensenbrink, who I think I would guess George and Jeff don't pick a class from him. So yes. I'm completely sheltered and clueless. And the first thing is there's this student, it's the first year we have women formally at Bowdoin. This one young lady, she's from California and she's breastfeeding during the circular lecture. And I'm like, oh man, you're not in Kansas anymore. And then another guy has this African garb on. And you're right, George, there are a lot of Marxists. And I was close to one my first 2 years. I did a flip after I read Ayn Rand my junior year. But man, the place just opened my eyes to how sheltered I'd been. And I met so many intelligent people from different cultures. But the other thing is that this concept of the common good and the whole culture of Bowdoin, a lot of my best Bowdoin experience came in 1990 when I joined the board, and was very proud of the fact that Williams produced 25 times the CEOs of Bowdoin, but Bowdoin produced guys like George Khaldun and Geoff Canada, Ellen Baxter, others that were moving the needle out there in a different way. And I really think my education at Bowdoin, it wasn't a how-to education, it was more of how to think. And having a liberal arts background, in my business, you need to be open-minded and think outside the box. If you think like everybody else, you lose money. And Bowdoin just opened my eyes in so many ways. And Bowdoin, as most of you know, is a cult. I love being a part of the cult. And I've enjoyed hanging out with ex-Bowdoin people as much as I did my campus time. So that's my introduction to Bowdoin.
Thank you, guys. So let's pivot into the Harlem Children's Zone and the model that you have you put in place, which is, as I think you described it in the film, Harlem Rising, cradle to college graduation. Now, pulling that off is no mean feat. So how did you come to that view? Was that something that you walked in with saying, we're gonna, at the founding here, we're gonna do this? And then what were the challenges along the way, and what remain the challenges to kind of living that model today?
Well, first I want to say that if it weren't for these two other folks who are here from Bowdoin, none of this would have happened. And I mean that, and for very, very different reasons. So I was working at an organization named Reedland. We were working with kids from 5 to 12. And if you had asked me if we were doing a good job, I would tell you yes. Kids look good. I believed early childhood, get them early. Everything was going to be fine. And I was just chugging along, just thinking, boy, this is great. And then I got really into data, right? And people kept asking me, well, how do you know? I know because I saw, you know, Susie and then Anthony looked good when I saw him. But they were like, but do you have any numbers? And the more I began to look at the numbers, the clearer it became to me that these kids weren't doing well. They were doing well when they were with me, but then they started running into problems in middle school and they started running into problems in high school. And I kept saying to myself, there has to be a better way to sort of solve these problems of intergenerational poverty. When I started thinking about this, I'll tell you, one of the biggest obstacles was that folks who I needed to support this work, because we weren't going to get public dollars, there were very few takers, because literally no one had done it before. No one had gone into an inner city community with this sort of comprehensive vision, not just from cradle to career, but changing the actual physical structure, cleaning things up, removing graffiti, fixing the parks and the playgrounds, trying to create an environment that was safe for kids. And so I had this vision, and you had to be kind of crazy to believe in it. And so the first crazy person was George, who I talked into joining me on this. And the second crazy person was Stan, who, you know, said, I'm going to support you. We're going to figure out how we can get this done. You had to realize our budget skyrocketed thinking about this work. It wasn't public dollars for it, but the hope was if we were successful, then other people would learn from this work.
And if you think about the barriers of putting of that in place, Jeff, and I'll ask George and Stan also to comment on this. Were the barriers financial? Was that the most significant barrier to getting this done the right way? Or were there cultural barriers, political barriers? What's the if you really had to focus on a single thing out of all the things that were in your way, what would it have been? What was it? What is it?
That's a great question. For me, the answer is that Black Lives Matter. I mean, that sounds trite today, but getting people to believe that these poor children who had nothing, who had lousy schools and apartments that were falling down and living with vermin, that they deserved a better experience than that. And if we could figure out a way to do it, then we had to do that. That was a huge obstacle. People kept saying, no, you can't do it. No, what you're trying to do, that's too much money. It's too complicated. Who could ever sort of do something like that? And that is where Stan and George came in, because for them, this issue of do these children matter? And now, you know, it seems like now everybody says that seems like, oh, yeah. Back 25 years ago, when we started talking about rebuilding places like Harlem, I got no takers. Folks simply said, nah, that can't be done. You'll never pull that off. So that was part of, to me, one of the biggest obstacles. Because once you give value to those children, then you say, we'll do what we have to do to make sure that they have a chance.
George, what would you add to that?
I'd like to add that one of the things that Jeff said, that we had no takers. The political community did not give us support. And we thought that we'd get support more from the Black politicians in particular to give us the support so that we could really make a dynamic change. So the community itself, another thing that was a hindrance was people didn't know who we were. So of course, who was this group? Who are these guys? Who were not even based in Central Harlem at the time? Who are these Ivy League guys who went to Bowdoin, Columbia, and Harvard? They're coming into our neighborhood to do what? And so that was a big hindrance in terms of getting the political people behind us to help give us the support. And so we were able to go outside of that in order to develop the Harlem Children's Zone. And I would like to say one thing. A lot of people talk about what we have done and how we have done it. But the key thing about the Harlem Children's Zone that made us successful was our culture. It wasn't the finance. It wasn't the individuals per se. It was the culture that Jeff helped create that gave us the motivation to move forward and to make changes. Jeff had this rule at our organization. It was called the whistleblower's law. The whistleblower's law was simply this. You could not abuse anyone. Anyone caught, you couldn't steal. You couldn't lie. You couldn't cheat. So we created a culture. And so in creating that culture, that allowed us to go ahead and begin to raise money in order to support the organization, because the culture lived on. It wasn't the finance we received. It wasn't the gifts we received from others. It was our culture of, and the culture dealt with high morals, dealing with our people fairly, and being correct in terms of our interactions with them. Then once we developed the culture, we were able to attract funding and other things. So I'm saying that the Harlem Children's Zone, in terms of our overall development, we overcame obstacles because we had esprit de corps, we had a value system, which allowed us to push forward.
Stan, what would you add?
It was definitely not financial. There was just, the neighborhood looked so dilapidated, and there was such a history of the kids and the grown-ups too in the neighborhood being screwed, that there wasn't much hope. And to George's point, the school system was terrible. And, you know, I had grown up believing America was a meritocracy, and if you worked hard and pulled up your bootstraps, you would succeed. But when I saw that neighborhood, I said, holy cow, I mean, I don't know how we're going to turn this around. But, you know, you've all now had quite a bit of experience with Geoff Canada. I met him in 1993 and with George, by the way, Rasuli Lewis and Sean Dove, and I was just like completely smitten. And I had spent so much time in business that if you have a great leader, you can pull anything off. And I didn't really believe it, but when Jeff said he wanted to do this, I wanted to take a shot because I had made so much more money than I ever dreamed of, and I wanted to make it matter. So it was definitely not financial. I think it was all of the above. It looked like a tough nut to crack.
I want to turn to a lot of great questions here from members of our community. And I'm taking them slightly, I'm going to take them out of order to try to match them up and mix them up a little bit. But Joe Leghorn, I was very impressed that the two financial backers in the film, and I hate labels on people who are viewed as conservative, that would be you and Ken Langone, Stan, came together with what could be viewed as a liberal cause. What can you offer to us and the country about how to communicate through and around so-called partisan barriers? You all did God's work together or doing it together, an important lesson to teach us. So let me, Stan, start with you on that.
I never looked at it as a liberal cause. I looked at it as giving a certain small percentage of our population a shot at the American dream. And to me, it is un-American not to have a shot at the American dream. And that's about, excuse me to the liberals in the audience, but that's about a conservative as a principle as you could have, is that the opportunity to make something of yourself in this country. So to me, I didn't think conservatives, liberals, that didn't matter to me. I just knew there were a bunch of kids who I knew were just like the kids in my neighborhood, except they never had a shot because of the stuff they had to deal with at home, because of the horrible schools they went to. And I just wanted them to have a shot. And I don't think that's a liberal cause. I don't think it's a conservative cause. I just think it's what I grew up believing in America.
Jeff?
So I think George sort of alluded to a reality that we faced. Coming out of school, we had this belief, right? We had a great plan. We're going to go to our people. They're going to support us. They're going to help us save our kids. And off we went and nothing. And we found out that with some of the stuff we cared about, schools, education, the Democrats ended up being horrible on many of these areas. And suddenly we started thinking, let's quit thinking this is a Democratic or Republican issue. Let's figure out who's prepared to invest their own time and energy and money in poor kids. And guess what? We found out there was not a color litmus test for that. There wasn't a political litmus test for that. There were plenty of black and brown people who would not invest. There were plenty who did. There were plenty of white people who would not invest. There were plenty who did. So what George and I started saying, we got to get rid of the labels if we care about this issue. And we're going to have to find out who is prepared to put themselves on the line. And there'd be lots of folks that you would have thought would have embraced this effort who did not. And lots of folks who thought who would not have embraced this effort who did. And I think that when it comes to this kind of work, it's perfectly fine. Kenny, Stan, George and I don't have to agree on who should be the labor secretary or the head of the treasury or what sort of the economic strategy should. Great to have those conversations. Will you help me save poor black and brown children? And if the answer to that is yes, then I want to have a conversation and I want to see if we can move. We can have these other conversations over a glass of white wine or red wine, whatever kind of wine you want to drink, right? But that comes after the work, which is about saving young people.
So George, let me just put a slightly personal twist on this question for you. As a self-proclaimed revolutionary, right? And the background you brought into Bowdoin and left with Bowdoin, what was it like when you started to sit with Stan and Ken and others from the financial community to do this work? Was it a natural thing? Was it, what did your thought processes change about that? And I'm interested in how you're thinking about that.
You hit it on the head. My thought processes changed because I was a Black nationalist, socialist, communist, feeling that the white working class or the white middle class did not give a damn about Black people. But interacting with Stan and others, it changed my view in terms of people looking at people differently. And it wasn't about the color of their skin or their political philosophy. It was about, did they want to help Black kids succeed? So my view was definitely changed.
All right, I want to shift gears here. And there are several questions that are in the theme that I'm going to describe that has several parts. But it's about the challenge of replication. And it comes in a couple of flavors. In the Obama administration, as the film describes very well, I think there were 52 cities that were targeted for replication. And the first question I would have, and that comes from our community, is what are the challenges of replicating this outside of the Harlem Children's Zone? How's it going in those places that were targeted? And the question that's asked here, and can this be done without the three of you, without Ken Langone and the few others, but the core, and often it comes to you, Jeff, but can this be done without the three of you?
Those are great questions. And in all modesty, I don't think in the first 5 or 10 years of us doing this work, the answer to that question would have been yes, right? But we were in uncharted territory. We didn't have the data. We didn't have the results. As Stan will tell you, we made plenty of errors that we had to correct and fix. And that's what we spent our time doing. But part of what happened during that process was a movement started in this country. And hundreds, 400 or 500 different communities came to our Practitioners Institute. And here, I have to say that originally, Clayton, three people I love, not excluding you, sorry, it's not that I don't love you, I'm not trying to say that, three people I love would have been on this screen. And one was a Bowdoin graduate, Rasuli Lewis, who was in school with George and myself. He ran our Practitioners Institute, and he helped build out the infrastructure around this country of folks who are currently doing this work from one end of America to the other, in fact, all over the world. And so now that we have some experience, we have some data, we have some results, and we have practitioners in different places that are actually delivering results right now. These are not fledgling enterprises, they're fairly mature. I think the answer to that is yes. I created a new institute called the William Julius Wilson Institute because some of another board that Stan is the chair of is supporting work around the country and building these kinds of cradle to career efforts. And we're gonna provide technical assistance from the Harlem Children's Zone to kind of take those entities and put them on steroids to meet the moment that we find ourselves in today.
Stan or George, what else would you add to that?
Well, as George and Jeff know, the first 10 years, every board meeting, some board member would suggest we do this in another city. And I always shot it down because I didn't think we had the data. And I was also terrified we didn't have the leaders. And I was convinced when you went outside of New York City, you didn't have the financial resources to pull this kind of thing off, particularly since back then, Clayton, philanthropy, a lot of it was centered around the arts. People have forgotten that the social sector and economic mobility didn't really become a thing within the philanthropic community till the last, I'd say, 10 years. What I will say now is a couple things. First of all, and I hope some of the Bowdoin students are listening to this, there is an army, and I mean an army of kids. Everybody dumps on this new generation. I got news for you. These kids out there, the ones I've met between 20 and 35, they are as talented as anybody I've ever met in the business community that want to go out there and change the world and build this kind of thing. So that checks one. The leadership question I had, you know, it's tough to duplicate Geoff Canada. In my opinion, with all due respect, Geoff, we already have with Kwame, yeah. And there's probably 5 or 10 more leaders out there amidst this army. So the leadership question is not what it was for me 10 or 15 years. And frankly, the financial isn't, because particularly on the West Coast with a lot of the new tech money, philanthropy has moved from this art thing to this economic mobility thing. And I think the funds are there. And if we can just show the same kind of data in some of these new cities we've seen at the Harlem Children's Zone, you'll have a public partner, a public-private partnership to fund that. So I'm actually was the number one negative pushback on this theory for 10 or 15 years. And I'm actually changing my tune, and I'm optimistic that these guys can pull this off.
Did the Obama initiative gain traction, and has it worked, however one wants to define work?
So if you look at the top organizations that are doing this work right now, all of the ones that we're looking at absent started off as Promise Neighborhoods. There were really significant efforts, and they look very different. In Berea, Kentucky, it's a rural effort, working with rural, mostly white folks. They have a terrific leader out there. She's doing great work, and she's demonstrated that this is not just an urban strategy. If you look at sort of Salt Lake City, very sophisticated effort being run through the United Way out there, really doing and delivering on this work. George worked with folks in Orlando, Florida, one of the best their children's project out there, the Paramore Kids Zone, just doing dramatic work, and they're expanding. It's by the way, it's funded totally by city government and state government, and they're expanding to different neighborhoods. So we've seen this thing begin to catch on around and take different forms, but all of it focused on places, neighborhoods, communities, and cradle to career efforts with young people.
George, when you
I would just like to add that, you know, Geoff mentioned Rasui Lewis in our Practitioners Institute, and we had over 300 or more organizations from around the country and internationally have visited the Harlem Children's Zone. And one of the things that we shared with them is that's 3 or 4 basic principles. One was to create best practice programs at each developmental age of a child's life. We encourage them to go to scale if that was possible. And we encouraged them to do community organizing whenever you could. And also we felt that by giving them some basic principles, they could go ahead and create the programs that work best with them in their particular neighborhood or community.
When you look I'm not asking you to name it, but when you look at a city or a neighborhood that hasn't worked well, is there a single thing that they don't get right in trying to make this happen?
Yeah, I think and when we began to see who was really doing great work at Promise Neighborhoods, communities that applied that actually weren't doing the work, but maybe was led by an institution that had terrific writers and maybe a great evaluation department, but they had no personal relationship with the communities they were working in, we found that those efforts tend to struggle and not be very successful. Part of this issue is this is hard work, and you've got to have some skin in the game. And if you think you can run an effort like this where your headquarters are 20 miles away from where the action is and everything's gone, that just we found has not worked really well. So where folks have a deep relationship with that community and have the capacity and the talent to really take on a sizable effort like this, we find much, much higher likelihood of success.
All right, so I want to just again acknowledge that there were a number of folks that sent in questions that all got put into that grouping, so thank you. Ms. Binnenfeld has sent in the following question. While watching the movie, many people talked about how special Harlem is and wanted to build pride for the community. However, one of the scholars interviewed said her goal was to, quote, go to college and move her family out of the city. What is your goal, each of you, for your scholars after college in terms of their relationship with Harlem?
I mean, that's terrific, George. I don't know, you want to start on that?
well, the way I look at it, one of the things that our core objective at the Harlem Children's Zone was to give children, young people, an opportunity to go to college and to develop skills. And with those skills, we would prefer for them to come back and build and work in Harlem. But with the skills that they have, they could, as far as I'm concerned, far as we're concerned, they can go anywhere. But the core thing is, what do they believe? Do they have the Harlem Children's Zone spirit to help people, to develop them, number one, to develop themselves and to help people who live in the community? So that's one of the ways I look at it. Our objective at the Harlem Children's Zone was to educate young people, give them the skills, and give them the opportunity to make their own decisions.
So, you know, it's a great question. When I went to Bowdoin, I thought I was coming back to the South Bronx to save South Bronx folks. But in 75, when I finished up at the Ed School at Harvard, we were in the middle of a recession. I couldn't get a job. I got a job in Boston. So I wasn't planning on staying in Boston, but you know what? I had a good education and I needed a job. I want the same for our kids. I want them to be able to take their skills and deal with, you know, all of us would love to say, you know, I would love to live here. But most times, especially young in your career, you have to follow where you get opportunities. And what we wanted to do was open up the opportunity door. But here was the key, Clayton. We didn't want people making a decision not to come back to Harlem because they thought it was a terrible place and they didn't want to live there. And that is the issue. That folks, I know kids say, Jeff, I want a lawn and a picket fence. Well, you ain't gonna get that in Harlem. I'm sorry, you know, you have to go somewhere. And there's nothing wrong with wanting that. I don't wanna say you shouldn't have that. Of course you should have that. What we want is a community that folks feel like is healthy for young people and families. And then children with an education, they make their own decisions.
Right.
Stan, anything
you want? I just want to add that we want children, young people, to have the options that everyone else has.
Yeah,
I would only say that it's very important to me that we break the cycle of generational poverty in Harlem. And I agree with what George said, and Jeff, if somebody wants to go work with a picket fence, fine. But it would be great if there's enough of a circular thing here that they come back and that community doesn't look like it did 25 years ago, which it does not. And more importantly, doesn't look 20 years from now like it does now, that we make continued progress. So it's kind of nuanced, but I don't want kids going to our best kids in Harlem going to some private school in Upper Manhattan and never coming back to the community. On the other hand, I don't want to deny kids who go off and succeed and don't want to live in Harlem, but it's really important to me that we break the cycle of poverty in Harlem.
And the vast majority of our children come back to Harlem. So this is not like, we're losing 30% of the kids are going somewhere else. They basically come back to the Harlem.
So a question from Megan Doyle. The success of the Harlem Children's Zone seems to be largely measured through improved standardized test scores. At the same time, many have called standardized tests racially biased and advocate for their elimination. Schools like Bowdoin made a test optional. How do you account for the shift? And how do you think about that question?
I mean, it's a great question. And one where, what I would tell folks is when all of the white children have no privilege based on test scores, I'm going to stop worrying about test scores for black and brown children. But right now, your life is determined by certain tests, what schools, what high schools, what classes you can take. And, you know, I had this one very smart student who worked for us and really got on my case about, testing and preparing kids for the SAT. And I just said, you're really bright. What are you getting ready to do? He said, oh, I'm getting ready to go to law school. I said, so what are you spending your time? Oh, I got to pass the LSATs. So I started laughing. And I said, so you're going to tell me my kids shouldn't be able to pass the LSATs, and you're taking a private class to learn how to study for that? So is it fair? No, it's not fair. But until they change the game, I feel like our kids have to be able to play in the game. I think there's a movement now where people are moving away. These tests don't determine your intelligence and your, often they determine whether or not you've had the money to buy tutors and you know, take the extra classes. So it's not fair. But because it's not fair, we can't have our kids opt out. We've got to try and level the playing field so our kids can use those advantages to end up coming to good schools like Bowdoin and other great schools in this country.
George or Stan, anything you want to add to that?
No, I don't.
Okay, two questions that are related to one another here. First from Catherine Page. What was the largest reason for Harlem's initial broken education systems, right? Going way back here.
I mean, wow, that's a deep question because I think a lot of it had to do with the sort of increase in poverty in Central Harlem. My mother went to school in Harlem, and at the time she went to school, Harlem was not known for having horrible schools. Part of what happened to communities like Harlem was you began, because of segregation, you began to sort of deny folks any other place to live. Places became overcrowded. Then they didn't get the kind of resources, housing and otherwise. And they had this particular air of being a ghetto. When you have education systems where all of the other society is breaking down around kids, you find that those schools end up not working well. And then they become in themselves part of the problem. They didn't start out as part of the problem, but over time, as the community began to disintegrate around families, the schools began, because you know why? Because people didn't want to work there. People didn't want to come there. Teachers didn't want to stay there. Everybody wanted to go to a better place. So they became magnets for folks who weren't the best in particular at working with these populations of kids who had all these other needs that they were bringing into the schools. You layer on top of that the prejudice and racism that existed before you began to see African-Americans coming into the education system. My going through school, when I was in the South Bronx, I had one Black teacher in all through my elementary and junior high school, right? They just weren't there. Now, it's not like just bringing people of color going to suddenly improve broken education systems. We've seen that doesn't work. But there was a pretty open sort of prejudice. Folks were discouraged from doing academic things. So the school systems were broken in these kind of places and did not actually insist on sort of the education of poor children, particularly poor children of color.
George, anything you want to add?
I'm a pass.
Okay. All right, second question. This is from Hadley Horch, a member of our faculty. I'm going to build it out a little bit, Hadley, so give me a little latitude here. But I'm curious about the decision to build a charter school rather than work within the public school system in New York. And how did what did this decision allow that a public school approach didn't? And if you could talk a little bit about how you think today about the charter public challenge and so forth. And I know all of you, the three of you, have some views about all this.
Well, Stan, you was in the room when it happened, so I don't know if you want to start, because there's a history of us with the charter schools issue.
Well, first of all, we do work in the public schools. I'm going to hand this over to Jeff, but the reason we started a charter school was, given the nature of the public school system at the time, we could not afford to lose our kids from 9 a.m. to 3:30 a.m. 9 a.m. to 3:30 p.m., excuse me, because we were in these kids' homes. We were doing everything with them, but if you lose them in the school system, so Jeff actually came to me. This was not our original decision. We were only going to work with the public schools, and told me 3 years in, Stan, we got to get in the school business. I'm going to let him take it from there. But we have had involvement inside the public schools. This is a myth about the Harlem Children's Zone.
Yeah.
from day one, and we still do, and we're very dedicated to that.
That's right. And fully 25% of our kids are in our charter schools, 75% are in the traditional public schools. But here was the challenge. So I had this dream of actually partnering with the public schools because I thought we could improve them, right? I thought we had some ideas and we could improve them. And I went to Joel Klein, who was our superintendent. I said, hey, Joe, I'd like to be a partner. I have a board. We'll raise some money. And he just started laughing. He said, how old are you? And I don't know. At that time, I was probably like 52. He said, if you want to do this when you're 80, try it your way. You'll never get through the bureaucracy. There's no sharing of power in schools. And part of this is I'm not going to get into the whole Ocean Hill-Brownsville issue. When Black and brown communities tried to take over schools, and the union struck throughout all of New York, they shut all of New York City down, and it scared all of the foundation from being involved in public education. From that point on, communities had nothing to say about the education of their children. So even though these kids were in our community, we could not say anything about their education. We thought, maybe naively, that if you could eliminate the achievement gap between Black and brown and white children, the public schools would say, okay, you got the answer, great, we'll go there. So we've eliminated it. But because there's still this thing that this is a charter school and this is a traditional public school, as if charter schools aren't public schools, people are not willing to do the tough work it takes to educate children in these communities, because it's not like a rocket science, but it sure is not easy. And if you're going to do it, you're going to have to do it like we do. You're going to have to work weekends and summer times and during the holidays. That's what we do to try and help our young people, whether they're in our charter schools or not. That's what we think it takes.
One of the things I would like to add is that we realized early on that many of our kids were 2 and 3 years behind. And in order for them to catch up, one of the things that Jeff developed was we had a longer school day and we had a longer school year. So if a kid is two or 3 years behind, and we had to develop a new system which would allow that child to catch up so he or she can graduate on time and go off to college. So that's one of the reasons why we started our charter school.
One of the first thing Jeff and George showed me early on was about 95% of the achievement gap took place from when traditional public school ended to when it started in the summer, because of the different home situation, the different environment, parents teaching them. And so the first thing they wanted to do was extend the school year to 11 months. Can you imagine going to the public schools and tell them we want you to work 11 months? And by the way, from 7:30 in the morning till 8. And I just want to say, it sickens me what's going on now, because when you take that 3 month period and what our kids lost, and you extend it now to a year, and you have teachers who are perfectly happy with these kids not getting that interaction in the school, it's hurting Black and brown children so much more than white children and rich kids. Even if the rich kids weren't going to school, and they are going to school in person. So just take that 3 month achievement gap that we had to keep overwhelming and extend it to 12 months. It's just tough to watch what's going on in Chicago and some of these other cities.
This is a question from Kim McCabe that is related a little bit to some of what you've just said here. How did you successfully create the culture of high morals, ethics, personal responsibility, accountability that made the Harlem Children's Zone so successful and that George talked about? And it's one thing to say, this is what we're gonna do. How did that become a reality of the culture?
I mean, that's a great question. People have labels, conservative, liberal. When it comes to our young people, I have what most people would probably call a conservative values. I believe that our young people need real role models. And that means that we come to work, we look a certain way, we speak a certain way, we project an image that says to them, we're preparing you for a world that may not look like Harlem. It may, but it may not. One of the real challenges, I think, in leadership in this country is that often leaders are not given an opportunity to understand that everybody is watching you all the time to see whether or not you mean what you say. Let's see where you are preaching one thing and doing something else. Our culture was led by his George and Rasuli. I have to go back to folks, but I have to say the Bowdoin folks. There were other folks who were there. Katie Shoemaker, white woman from Bowdoin, ran our policy work, helped get promised neighborhoods in the country. This idea that we had to carry ourselves a certain way, which meant that we had to project to our community. As Stan said, people never saw me without a tie on. And it's funny, this is part of the cultural thing. When Stan knows our toughest site was on 144th Street. When we first went on 144th Street, George, Rasuli, and I, all in our jackets and ties, everybody thought that we were FBI agents looking for, right? Because they were like, what is three black guys with suit and ties doing on 144th Street, right? That's the culture, right, that happens in so many poor communities because they're so closed off. And we wanted to come in and say, no, there's a new sort of sheriff in town. But the idea of how you treat people regardless of their religion, their sexual orientation, how we make sure that folks know they get promoted, not because they're my friend. George knows. George, what's the one thing I would tell everybody about your and my relationship when it came to work and data?
Jeff used to always say, and this was so embarrassing, whenever we would have large meetings with 200 staff there or 300 staff, he would say, and this, even George, if he messes up, he's fired. And I was always like, oh my gosh, he has to say this again. But the thing is, what made it work was that we made sure it happened. When one of our directors abused us, another person verbally or whatever, that director would be brought in. We would talk to him. If we find out that person abused somebody, we would let him go. And that word went out among the among our staff, knowing that we run a legitimate organization, a moral organization, and we didn't stand for any type of physical, moral, or emotional abuse from our staff and our leaders within our organization. And that created a culture where people felt comfortable. But Jeff would say this at every meeting that we got to, but the end of the thing, he would say, and even if George did this, he would be fired. So.
Not that he remembers that, but I had a feeling he would. But Clayton, here's the deal, and everybody knew it. I wasn't kidding, right? George, Rasul, everybody, this wasn't about friendship. This wasn't because I went to school with you, or I thought you guys were good guys, or your church fair. Now, this was about, are you prepared to do the work and hold yourself accountable? And if the answer to that was no, you could not stay with this organization because the mission was more important to me and to George, Rasuli, and to Stan than any of the personality stuff that I think drives organization. So no lunches, no going out with anybody. I don't have tea with people. No, I don't go to lunch with George. It was just, no, this is business and business is business. And you can move up in the organization because you save and educate poor black and brown children. The better you do that, the higher you're gonna get up in our organization.
I would just like to add, the only time I went to dinner or lunch with Jeff was when he recruited me. I had just graduated from Columbia School of Education. I had no money and I was always hungry. He took me to lunch. And I said, and that's where he recruited me. The guy said, no, Jeff, I'm not going there. No, he said, come. Give me 6 months. 25 years later, I was still there.
All right, we're sadly coming to the end of the hour here. We got lots of questions. This has been a remarkable discussion. I want to do two things. The first is to ask each of you quickly for your thoughts on advice, admonition to our students who are out there. And I'll, Stan, I'll start with you and then work our way around the screen here.
My only advice would be follow your passion. And, you know, I've been blessed to be in a job that I love that has ridiculous financial remuneration, but that's not why I'm in it. And whatever your passion is, follow it. And you see, these are two of the most moral accomplished men I've ever met. And they certainly weren't going to Wall Street or now there's nothing wrong with going to Wall Street. But just whatever it is that really, really moves it for you in life, that's where you should go. That'd be my only advice. But I would say that this is a whole new world out there. And I sure hope we produce some George Khalduns and Geoff Canadas out of this audience today, because they're doing God's work.
George?
I'm mentoring two sophomores who are at Bowdoin right now. And one of the things that I tell them all the time, they talk about how heavy the work is and how they're frustrated. And I would tell them that when I was at Bowdoin, every summer I would go home and say, I'm not going back because I'm intellectually exhausted. And I would come back. So I give them that story to let them know that what they're doing at Bowdoin now, their courses is to work hard and to focus on developing their intellectual capacity so that when they come out, they would be a benefit to our community.
Jeff?
Yeah, Clayton, and you know, it wasn't until after the film was completed that I realized what an important central role Bowdoin played. Not only in my life and George's, Stan's, Vasily's, but in the work at the Harlem Children's Home as our students came up to Bowdoin in the summertime and other things. And this is what I would say to students. Don't play yourself short. You know, I came to Bowdoin thinking that I could figure out an answer to poverty in the South Bronx. I was 18, pretty arrogant to think such a thing was possible. But that was my dream. It sort of was like Stan said, that was my passion. And I just followed that passion at Bowdoin. I feel like this is a special place. And it's funny because when it used to be with George and Rasuli and Stan and I, Katie Shoemaker, Eric Bell, we were all together. There were more Bowdoin people than anybody else at the Harlem Children's Home. Now that we're kind of all gone, there's a bunch of Harvard types there and I'm hearing all these stories. But I always tell them one thing. I don't know how many people from Harvard it takes to change the world, but I know how many it takes from Bowdoin. It was six of us. And people need to remember that. Special place, don't sell yourself short. Keep your dreams alive and follow your passion.
Good.
Well, on that note, I think we will end it. There's nothing more to say to that. Stan and George and Jeff, thank you. Thank you for the amazing work that you do. Thank you for being with us and sharing the time and the thoughts, the wisdom, the passion, and it's been a remarkable hour. I'm so grateful that you're part of the Bowdoin community. So thank you.
Thanks, Clayton.
Thank you. Thank you,
everybody.